Hello there, everyone, and welcome to How to Alleviate Neck Pain, Headaches, and Migraines. My name is Dr. Craig Heinsohn, and today this is your walkthrough, talk-through guide of the Ultimate Chiropractic Guidebook, Volume 1, which is to do with the upper spine. Okay, so let's just dive straight in. How to use this workbook? So what I suggest is, first thing to do is to try a bird's eye view scan through. So just look through the material, just get an overall understanding or at least an overall view of the material. Then, if you want to get more information on a subject, then there are plenty of links. You can click on them and drill down to more detailed information. So we have things like videos, video demonstrations, PDF, and transcripts. Okay, and indeed, if you're seeing this on YouTube, then you may not have the book. So if you go down to the description, you can actually get the PDF workbook down below. Just click on that link, I'll take you straight there. If not, then obviously the click here is just giving you instructions to click, and I'll get you through to this YouTube video that you're now watching, okay? The other thing is to print off worksheets when conducting the spinal hygiene exercises. So we have some awesome spinal hygiene exercises for you, which are designed to help remove imbalance in the nerve system, imbalance in the spine, and allow you to hold your adjustment or allow your spine to be stronger for longer. Okay, so let's get on to the contents. We've already talked about the first two. We're gonna cover our purpose, why. Why are we doing the work that we do? A little bit about your doctor, a little bit about anatomy of the upper spine, how to get results, all pretty self-explanatory. The chronic nerve system interference, three biggest mistakes leading to neck pain, headaches, and migraines. Some exercises and healthy habits for you to start right now with videos and sheets and stuff. We're gonna explain why your body is a temple, and we're gonna explain what's next. Okay, so let's just dive straight in. Our purpose at Loving Life Chiropractic is to help raise your health, raise the health of your family so that you can do what you love for longer. Okay, so that's our thing. We want you to be able to do what you love for longer, whether it's work, whether it's playing with your grandkids or your children, whether it's weight training or even just putting on your socks. We want you to be able to do that and for longer. Now, why do we feel that we're necessary? Now, I don't know if you noticed, but there's a crisis in healthcare. I do hundreds and hundreds of workshops every year. And one of the key questions I ask is, how do people feel? How do the audience feel as far as the health of the nation goes in terms of chronic issues, things like diabetes, things like allergies, asthma, stroke, heart disease? Is it getting worse or is it getting better? And to a person, every man in the audience or every person in the audience says that, yeah, as far as they can see, we're spending more money, we're investing more time in it, there's more advertising on it, and yet it still seems to be getting worse. So that, as you'll see, and the statistics indeed show that. But even before things like smartphone technology that came along in 2005, so why is that relevant? So people looking down at their smartphones now, there's two aspects of it. There's an addiction, and then there's the fact that we're sitting in this C-shaped, or we're stood in this C-shape, we're always constantly looking down. It's destroying posture. That has already been identified. And additionally, there's obviously the 2020-2021 viral health scare that further exacerbates things like isolationism, a lack of exercise, poor oxygenation, which are all going to have their own significant health issues in due course. But even before all of that, in 2009, on the subject of health and longevity, the United States Center for Disease Control, which is a pretty powerful and massive organization, made this statement. People have never been sicker. For the first time in the history of man, children born after the year 2000 are not expected to live as long as their parents. So, I don't know about you, but I am not okay with this, definitely not okay with it. You know, for me, it's got a particular significance because I've got two children and both of them were born after 2000, okay? And also from my experience of being involved in chiropractic health, you know, for the last almost 20 years, I know it doesn't have to be that way. Okay, and that's one of the reasons I put together this little guidebook for you. So a little bit about myself. So my name is Dr. Craig Heinsohn. I'm a chiropractor in Ottawa, and I was born in the UK though, born in Scotland actually, and I was brought up in the southwest of England, a city called Bath. I joined the military at the age of 18 as an engineer, or I joined the Navy as an engineer. I did a ton of training in Plymouth, and it was in Plymouth that I met my wife. Now, why am I telling you all this? It's just myself and Dr. Marie Claude, we've traveled tens of thousands of miles listening to speakers, and what I always find is I always get a little more out of it if I understand a little bit about where the speaker's from. So I hope it's okay. I'm just going to share a little bit more, just be a couple of minutes. So I was in Plymouth, I met Dr. Marie Claude. Now, I was a military engineer, I'd already been to a war zone, I then went to two more, but I met Dr. Marie Claude and she said, I'm a chiropractor. And I said, oh yeah, bad necks, bad backs, it's a waste of time. My stepfather was in construction and he'd been to a chiropractor and that was his opinion, so obviously that was kind of what I'd inherited. And she said, no, you don't understand, I work with babies born addicted to drugs. I work with children on asthma inhalers. I help adults with learning difficulties. And you see, things for me were very black and white as an engineer, a military engineer as well. So that sounds a little bit strange, a little bit left field. And she said, look, if you want to go out with me, you've got to go to this workshop that my colleagues do. So I went to this chiropractic workshop, not that different to what we're going through at the moment. And it was an epiphany. It just blew my mind. I was like, yeah, that makes a lot of sense. I want to be involved in that. And that's how I first heard about chiropractic. So I put my notice in to leave the service. But before I left, that was around 9/11. In fact, I met Dr. Marie Claude a couple of weeks after 9/11. So I joined the Marine Commandos, basically to stay around Plymouth because I just got married. But then they got sent to Afghanistan and Iraq. So I was involved in the 2002 Afghanistan war and the 2003 Iraq war, where I was with the commandos, which was eye-opening, super interesting. And a lot of people, when they came back, lost their health because of stress type issues, PTSD type issues. I was the person responsible for decompression training, which was meant to make that transition easier. In truth, I actually lost my health as well about 6 months after returning. I was in a really dark place. Now, fortunately, I met this 80-year-old chiropractor. You know, he was on fire and he looked as though he was about 50 years old. The guy's called Reggie Gold. There's plenty of material on him on the internet, him speaking. And one of the things that I did, I started taking really regular chiropractic care, started eating well, I did a lot of other things. And I wrote a book on health recovery. That was 6 years before I became a chiropractor. So I actually was working and helping a lot of people before that. And I've been involved in chiropractic now for 18 years. Okay. Right, little anatomy of the upper spine. So to get the most out of this, you need to understand a little bit about your body. So this is an upper the spine volume. So this diagram here is an X-ray. For those of you that have never seen an X-ray before, white means it's dense material. So here, this is the shoulder. We're looking through the shoulder, kind of the X-ray shot into the ear, kind of out the other ear, as it were. This is the jaw, and then this here is the teeth. These teeth have a brace on, so the more dense it is, the more white it looks. The more dark it is, the more air density, so the less dense it is. So this area here is actually in the air. This is in the air as well. Okay. Now, the vertebrae, that's the spinal bones. This is the base of the skull. Okay, the skull disappears up here. Okay. And the skull sits on the top bone, it's called C1. C1 has also got another name, it's called Atlas, just like that legendary god that would hold the world in the air. So that's Atlas, that's because the skull sits directly on Atlas. Atlas is a ring, it's not a block. The rest of the bones, or majority of them, are blocks. The other specialist bone is this one here, it's called C2, or axis. It's called axis because it comes across, and this point up here, this pivot, is actually part of the same bone. So it's called the odontoid process. It's actually a pivot that C1 swings around. Because of this specialist nature of these three bones, that's the back of the skull, C1 and C2, when you look over your shoulder, and we should be able to look between 80 and 90 degrees, okay? If there's a restriction, then there's something going on. And Atlas and Axis provide 45 degrees of motion. So in other words, 50% of the rotation of the head come from these two bones. So if there's any imbalance here, it's going to radically affect how the spine's moving. Here's the other thing of note. This is the ideal curve, this green line here. This is running down the back of the vertebral bodies. So this area here, just behind that green line, that is exactly where the spinal cord runs. So we can see it down there. There it is running there. Okay, so in this case, this is the base of the brain. It's called the cerebellum. And this piece here is the brain stem coming down. This is kind of interesting, actually, now I look at this. So this is a different x-ray. This is the x-ray that belongs to this gentleman. This gentleman came in with back pain, didn't have neck pain, okay? Didn't have neck pain, none at all. Came in with back pain. And initially came in with back pain and then came back 6 months or so later, or 3 months later, I can't remember exactly. It was an excruciating neck pain. This has been going on for years and years and years. The reason I know that is you see this fat pad here. This has been forming as a response to really protecting the breakdown that's been happening here. Now, if I look on the x-ray, and we take x-ray with most people that come to see us because it gives us a ton of information. This is an MRI. You can see all the tissue, the fat, you can see the spinal cord, you can see the disc material. What that does, though, if there's too much information, sometimes you can't see the degeneration of the spine. You can't see the degeneration of the spinal curve quite so clearly as you can on an x-ray. That's why I love x-rays. MRIs are awesome, ultimate information, but this is great for what I want, which is to see how balanced the spine is. Now, with this gentleman here, if I look down here, you can't really see too close. So if you zoom into it, you might see it a lot better. But there's, compared to these discs, spaces, this disc space here looks a lot different. You look at the front of the bone, it's kind of rounded around the disc, so there's something definitely not right going on here when you look at it as an x-ray. And then he was able to bring in his MRI, and this is exactly the same level, and this is what's happening to the neurological material. So he was having tingling and numbness in both arms, which is a bad thing, and both legs, which is definitely not a good thing, all at the same time. So we adjusted his spine, removed interference. I'm going to talk about that a bit later. And he came to me saying, basically, I've got to have surgery in a month. I don't really want it. Is there anything that I can do? And we adjusted and adjusted and adjusted. And so with this gentleman, when we adjusted him, obviously his nervous system was able to come back, stay to balance, the structure improved. And that was 3 years ago, and he still not had the surgery that's being suggested. And obviously, from people respond differently, but for him, that was an outstanding result. Okay, so moving on. So there's a little bit of anatomy of the upper spine. Okay, so this is the how. How are we gonna get better results in your health? I'm gonna give you a little bit of history, but I do wanna keep it real, okay? So this chap in the hat on the left, this is Harvey Lillard. He was the first chiropractic patient ever. Story has it that D.D. Palmer here on the right, and I'm gonna give you a pop quiz. So what country do you think D.D. Palmer came from? What country do you think D.D. Palmer came from? Was it the United States? Was it Canada? Or was it Great Britain? Okay, so if there's a comment section here, just pop it in the comments. So where do you think? Okay, so I'll tell you the story and I'll let you know the answer in the end. So Lillard was a janitor. He was working in a stoop cramp position 17 years before meeting Palmer. He had something go in his neck. He heard a buzzing in his ears and he couldn't hear properly. He was partially deaf. There was a constant buzzing and he couldn't hear. They say he couldn't hear the racket of the wagon wheels on the cobbles outside his house, which in those days everybody could hear. And then Palmer adjusted him on the third occasion of making the first adjustment. On the third occasion, his hearing came back. Now that is the birth story for chiropractic, and a lot of people say, well, no, that's just ridiculous, that's not true. But in our office, we know it is true, you know, because this young man came to see us and he had a similar setup, and he had a similar situation. He was partially deaf, and his mother didn't want him to go to a special school where he learned to, because he couldn't speak properly at that time. And after his third visit to us, he turned around to his mum and said, "What's all that noise? Why is the TV on so loud? And why is my sister shouting at me?" Okay, now super important thing to understand. Chiropractic care is not a cure for deafness, okay? It's not even a cure for neck pain or back pain. What chiropractic does is bring balance back to the system, which in some cases allows people to recover things that they've lost. In other cases, there are other issues going on. So for example, if either of these individuals had lost the bones within their ears, they didn't have the equipment there, it doesn't matter how much you adjust them, the hearing's not going to come back. Chiropractic just removes nerve system interference. But once that's removed, the body is better able to heal. Okay. And just another, I see at the bottom, we have had a lot of people come into our office with hearing aids, and guess what? They left with hearing aids. But in a lot of cases, they were functioning a lot better in all different aspects of their life. Okay. The nerve system is, of course, the master control system. So this is how we get our results. The brain communicates down into the body through the spinal cord. That's the information superhighway. And at every level, a little bit like a fuse panel, there's a bundle of nerves that come out and they spread like roots in a tree to every cell, tissue, and body. So for example, the top of the neck, there's a blood supply to the head and the pituitary gland. Now, of note, the pituitary gland is the master chemical gland, the master hormone gland. So if this is out of balance, then everything changes. So this is where the nerve system interfaces with the endocrine system. Okay, and so the top of the neck, this is what we're talking about in this presentation, the top of the spine, which is C1 to C7. There are actually 8 nerves above and below those vertebrae. So for example, C8 here affects the diaphragm. So who'd have thought that a problem in your neck could affect how you're breathing down here where the diaphragm is? Okay. And you can have a look through that yourselves. You can see the different areas being affected that. So with like Harvey Lillard and Reese, and in fact with most of the original chiropractic patients, it wasn't anything to do with neck pain or back pain. And this is how they got results. They got results by removing interference on the nerve system. So really, really simple, chronic nerve interference. So in other words, nerve interference that's been there for a long time. Just start with how does it happen? It happens because of stress. There are 3 types of stress, emotional, chemical, and physical, and they can interfere with how the nerves are functioning. Now, that is if the body isn't able to adapt to those stresses, because we adapt to stresses all the time. If we're weight training, we're adapting to that physical stress, and actually that improves things. But if we have a bus land on us, there's obviously some physical stress there that the body isn't going to be able to adapt to. But at a lesser level, the body is just stressed in a negative way, and that then starts to interfere with the nerve system. The nerve system is what fires the muscles. So now, because we have the interference in the nerve system, the muscles aren't function quite as they should do, which means that the muscles obviously pull the structure out. So the muscles are out, now the structure is being pulled out, and over a period of time the discs, the bones, the soft material is going to change in a negative way, in an adverse way, and this in turn can start interfering with the nerves again. So we start forming this negative circle, and indeed that leads to a downward spiral of function of the body. And function is really what health is. Okay. Right. Oh, I'll go back to the original pop quiz. So did you put a comment on where you thought D.D. Palmer, the first chiropractor, came from? So anyone that put Canada, you are 100% right. D.D. Palmer was actually born just outside of Port Perry. And he emigrated at the age of 16 to the United States. Okay, what percentage of your nerves feel pain? So there are 3 different types of nerves in your body. There are motor nerves, there are organ nerves, also called autonomic nerves, but it really just means organ nerves, and there are sensory nerves. Okay, so they're the 3 different types of nerves you have. Now, sensory nerves, what percentage do you think they are? 100%, 70%, or 50%? So again, put it down in the comments below if there is comments. If there isn't, just jot it down, and I'll let you know in a moment or two. Okay, so this time we're going to cover the 3 biggest mistakes leading to neck pain, headaches, and migraines, and how to avoid them. Okay, so we've got some different spines there. Now, you guys aren't used to looking at spines, so I've just put this little illustration here, because spinal health is a little bit like dental health. 200 years ago, there was no dental health, and people's teeth lasted only a short time, only 40 years or so. And then we started dental health, and it wasn't until the 60s, even in the 60s, a lot of dentists were just like, well, we'll pull it out if it's hurting, but if it isn't hurting, let's not touch it. Because what do they say? If it isn't broke, don't fix it. And the trouble with that is your definition of being broken, my definition are very different. Most likely very different. Okay, and so in this first spine, this is the ideal spine. It's got this nice curve. It's got these discs that are nice and fat. The reason that's important is at the back of the disc, a disc is a spacer and it holds a channel open, and out of that channel comes a nerve. So we want those discs to be nice and fat. So not only is the spine and looking in good condition, but the person's happy as well because everything's working well. We don't know that, but you know, that's what I like to think. In this second one, you can see the curve is actually reversed here. It's not just straight, it's actually going back the other way. The discs at the top are fat, and down here they're very thin. And there's even calcium kind of fusing these areas. So this is what a spine like that looks like. Actually, maybe even slightly worse, but this is what it looks like. And then this last spine, to me, makes me kind of cringe. So the spinal hygiene here is completely gone. So it's an S shape. This is all cemented by calcium. This is emergency material being laid down to protect the spine. And then there's a big disc there. That's massive. That's just way too big. Okay, so that's kind of the tail end. Right, so what we want to avoid is premature spinal aging, okay? And if you can avoid these mistakes, this is gonna help you. Mistake number one is a poor definition of health, or the TV. Everything we've been told since we were born is that health is feeling good and looking good. So if you're feeling good and looking good, you're okay, right? So top three killers in Canada. Number one is cancer. Number two is heart disease. And number three is stroke. In 80% of cases of heart disease, any idea what the first symptom is? So again, just write it down, put it in the comments. The question again, in 80% of cases of heart disease, which is the second killer, the second biggest killer here in Canada, what do you think the first symptom is? So if you wrote down chest pain, well done, but you're not correct. If you wrote down tingling in the left arm, good guess, but it's not right. If you wrote down death, then you got it bang on. So in 80% of cases of heart disease, the second biggest killer in the country, the first symptom is death. So if you're using symptoms, how you're looking, how you're feeling to judge health, that you're on a very rocky slope or a very slippery slope. So is there a better definition than that? So the other thing is, if I ask you, do you know someone who's fit as fiddle, right as rain, never had a day off work in their life, and then went to see the GP with a little issue, or they thought was a little issue, found out they had cancer, found out they'd had a stroke, or were on the borderline of having a stroke, or indeed had heart disease, yeah? I don't know about you, but I know about four or five people, okay, like that. So when you're using symptoms to identify your health, then you're on a slippery slope, and there is a time and a place to use that, but just for general ongoing health, it isn't a good one, okay? Much better definition of health is functioning well. So if your body is functioning well, then you're healthy. Now you're probably thinking, well, isn't that the same thing? No, it's not the same thing. If someone stands on your foot, you're in excruciating pain. But you want to be in that pain so that you know to get out of the way. That's a correct function of the body, okay? If you had diabetes and the nerves to your foot were completely dead, you could have an elephant stand on your foot and you wouldn't realize. And indeed, it happened to my stepmother. She was walking around with a thumbtack in the base of her foot and didn't realize. She did that for about a week, and then it was infected and she was in all sorts of trouble. And it wasn't too long until she passed after that. But health is functioning well, not feeling well. Similarly, if I've been out for a beautiful meal with my other half, Dr. Marie Claude, come back from the Chinese, had a great meal, and didn't realize that there was some food poisoning there, and I spend the rest of the afternoon vomiting, Am I sick or am I healthy? So what do you think? Put it down below in the comments, quickly, quickly, or write it down. Well, actually, I am healthy. But look, even my language says Dr. Craig's being sick. So I'm not being sick. And, you know, if I rang up work and said, oh, I can't make it in today, I'm expressing perfect health, you'd think that I was a bit of an idiot, you know? So they'd say, well, get in. But of course, I'm in, and we say that we're being sick. You know, it's actually a very healthy response. Do I feel good? No, I don't feel good. And I'm not meant to feel good because there's poison coming out of my system. Okay, but if it goes into my bloodstream because I don't vomit or I don't feel bad, then I'm going to be dead or in hospital. Okay. All right, so let's go to mistake number two, having no strategy for turning your health around. So what do I mean by that? Okay, we've got something called a three-legged stool, okay? And that consists of three things. This is the strategy for turning your health around. For in other words, for breaking that downward cycle of health that we talked about. Adjustments in rhythm. Now, this is the chiropractic intervention. This is a very minimal thrust, in some cases done very, very lightly with an instrument. I know there's all sorts of stuff on YouTube and on the internet and on TV of chiropractors that are competing to make the loudest cracks. That is not chiropractic. They may be doing chiropractic moves or techniques, but that's not what the aim is. The aim is to make a correction. And you can make a correction completely silently. So we have some ninja moves here that we use, and there's a lot of chiropractors that have some very light touch moves. And then the whole idea of that is to start to access the nerve system or the structural system or the muscle system. I personally find that accessing the nerve system is much more effective. It's much lighter touch and it has much longer lasting results. That's my personal experience. And then the second one is specific spinal hygiene exercises. It's a little bit like brushing your teeth or flossing. This is the extra thing. It's just to keep your body holding the adjustment for longer. And then the third one is the big pieces, of the big stones in the glass, if you will. And that is breaking bad habits. We do that how? We can't just take a bad habit away. We've got to replace it with something. So we adopt loving habits. And we have four workshops that we regularly do with our practice members. That is loving food, loving rest, loving thought, and loving movement. So we talk to people about things they can do that's much more loving to their body. And that those together help help the body be healthier, function better, hold the adjustment better, heal better, move better. So raise your health. Okay. So here we go. Adjustments in rhythm, breaking the downward spiral. Here's me making an adjustment here. This is more of a structural adjustment. Rather than a light touch one, because otherwise you wouldn't see anything with a light touch adjustment. And here we have the specific adjustments in rhythm, having positive positive impressions on the nerve system, and it starts to change the nerve system. Okay, starts to take pressure interference off the nerve system. Now the muscles are back in balance, the musculature is in balance, the skeleton is able to be in a more relaxed, more balanced position, the structure. This allows the body to heal and repair, and in turn that takes more pressure off the nerve system. Okay, so that's the adjustive process. This is obviously an illustration. The changes are very, very small often, and sometimes a little profound, but there is obviously a matter of time as well. The longer we can keep things going in a positive direction, the more of an upward spiral of function we're going to have. In other words, the more health we have. Okay. Leg two of that strategy, specific spinal hygiene exercises. As I said, this is like floss for your spine. One of the ones we talk about is the tummy time exercise. This is the most powerful exercise that I give people. This is helping the brain reconnect with the neck muscles. As a baby, tummy time between 8 and 16 months, you're looking up over the shoulder. As you do that, that is actually developing the second curve in the spine, which is the neck curve. And then the neck curve is one of the most mobile and therefore one of the most unstable sections of the spine, which is why that needs to be maintained in an optimum position. so that you can do what you love for longer. Okay, so we have some exercises for you. This is the exercise sheet. You're more than welcome to print this off. Have a copy of this. It tells you the form and the reps. Put it by your bed or by your little exercise space. If you click on the links here, they're going to take you to the exercises, and that's going to help you keep your good form and get some great results. We've got a result sheet here, so just fill in your details, whichever exercise. For if you're starting, just do the first month solely tummy time exercise. Do the tummy time cervical exercise. Get that into a habit. At the end of the day, you know, brushing your teeth is not an exercise, but it has massive health benefits. These aren't really exercises, these are healthy habits. So do them regularly and you're going to see some massive benefits. And then the third one is breaking those bad habits, adopting loving habits, as I mentioned. So this is the loving nutrition, loving movement, loving thought, and loving rest. Your body is a temple. I don't know if anyone's ever told you that before. Your body is a temple. Okay, it is a loving life temple. If we get things right, then the roof of your temple, which is the health, your resilience to stresses, if we get this right, then the roof of the temple is even stronger than usual. Okay, these pillars, we talk about what you could do to reinforce these pillars for sure. Okay, and there'll be some workshops coming up very shortly. Just look at our events section and you'll see what's happening. I've got some of them online, you can join into them, some of them offline, you just need to come here. Now, whilst these are the pillars, what I deal with in the chiropractic office mostly is your foundation. And that foundation is loving power, okay? That is the central nerve system. Because all of these aspects of life, you could have the best nutrition program on the planet, but if the nerves going to your stomach aren't free of interference, if they're not if the signals aren't as powerful as they should be or as congruent as they should be, then you're not going to get all you can out of your health. Does that make sense? Okay, so that's that one. And yeah, and click on down below there, just check out the events and see what we've got. Okay, so I hope you enjoy that little canter through our guidebook. That's just to get you going in the right direction. So this is where we are. I'm Dr. Craig Heinsohn, Loving Life Chiropractic, 842 Byron Avenue in Ottawa, K2A0H8. Give us a call anytime on 613-725-2525. And if you're passing by, come in and say hi. Have a cup of tea with us. Let me know what you thought of this guidebook, all right? Also, we've already talked about our live events. I've got a YouTube channel. I post a lot of the stuff. In fact, a lot of the videos here are actually on that YouTube channel. So just visit it, subscribe, so that when I produce a video, you're going to be amongst the first people to know what's going on. And I always like to give a shout out to new members of the family, of the YouTube family. I've got a Facebook page here. Again, we post all sorts of cool stuff there. Like thoughts for the day. We have a Monday morning motivation on Monday, Wednesday and Friday, so that's to keep you going all week. And yeah, feel free to share and like and share this material. You do have my permission to share this guidebook with your friends and family, and see if they can get some use out of it. Okay, and my favorite guy, Mr. Dr. BJ Palmer, we never know how far reaching something we may say, think or do today will affect the lives of millions tomorrow. So just reach out there, try and help friends and family members, and you know as well as I do, that comes back to you tenfold. Thanks a lot. Take care.